Okay, so just continue from the point of discussion from the previous session. I think we have completed the compound interest, and this is what probably an interesting thing that you should know as a civil engineer. And minimum attractive rate of return are pretty much related to a construction financing thing rather than basic financing. And the nominal interest rate, APR, which is nothing but annual percentage rate. And effective interest rate, which is nothing but APY, it's annual percentage yield. So we'll generally talk about interest rate or rate of interest in terms of a generic perspective. Say the bank will give you in terms of a 10% of interest, but it doesn't tell you about the time value of money. So 100 rupee now and 100 rupee in 1950, the denomination are the same, but the value is different. So 100 rupee in 1950s is a huge money. But that is not certainly the case with the 100 rupee now. So that is what we call a effective interest or something like that has to associated with your money. Say somebody borrows you 1,000 rupee now and just say, I'll repay you in a simple interest, a 10% of interest annually. And in the 5 years, they will be paying you 1,500. The 500 is your interest money. The 500 after 5 years may not be a very, very comprehensive money or a lump sum. It's not a very huge money of 500 rupee after 5 years. So that is what a nominal interest and an effective interest matters. But if you talk about this compound interest, in the effective interest rate, they talks about the time value of money. So that at the end of 5th year, you'll get 1,610, just slightly higher than the nominal interest rate. It won't be too much higher, but some quantum will be higher. That is what it called as annual percentage yield rather than rate. Then minimum attractive rate of return is something like which you will be fixed. There's no proper guidelines or something. Say for example, in a smaller sense, I can tell you the auction. In the auction, people show a material or an antique product. They just say the base price is 500 rupee and people quote for it like 501, 505. It can go till the higher the bid, the that items is sold to that particular person. So that is what we call a minimum attractive rate of return, which means that you decide the rate of interest for your investment or something. If the bank proposes its interest rate, if your MARR is higher than your what do you call the bank's proposal, then probably you will reject the proposal. But if the MAR is less than the bank's proposal, I mean the rate of interest in a sense, but the return money, if it is very high than your minimum amount, then you accept the proposal by the bank or any construction business or anything like any other industry or something like that. So that is what it is called minimum attractive rate of return. This is purely a construction financing terminology, but it has also its influence in other sectors as well. We talked about this compound interest and the formula for the compound interest, and this is what we talked about, the nominal and effective. So effective rate, which is nothing but annual percentage yield equals to 1 plus annual percentage rate divided by k and whole power k minus 1. So which means that this k, particularly this is the factor that determines the what do you call your yield based on the nominal interest. So it's not only a simple static calculation, but it's a dynamic calculation. Supposing your K is annually, so it is calculated based on yearly, how frequently the payment is released or how frequently your interest is given. Say for example, K is the number of chunks of interest period per year. If it is per annually, then it is 1, K equals to 1. So this 1 year in one, I mean 1 year is taken as 1. Then semi-annually is biannually, every 6 months they take 2, and quarterly is 4, and bi-monthly is 6, and monthly is 12, so 12 months in a year, and fortnightly is 15 days. This is nothing but twice a month, so 2 times you'll get in a month, so 12 into 2 is 24, and weekly is 52 weeks approximately in a year, and daily is 365, if it is a leap year, it will be 366, something like that. And that will be the value of K will be given here. Okay, so we take quick example. In this example, we just say what is the balance. What does this has to do with the production is, productions are done generally in a lot. Say for example, they don't there's something called short run. We'll talk about that a little later, but short run production and long run production. You should really look into the capital gets invested in a short run and capital gets invested in long run. So long run, the years are very huge and you should be pretty much take account the rate of interest and its influence. Say for example, in this case, I wanted to know what happens after 5 years if I have 10,000 at this point of time. Investment is a capital, 12% per year. It's the rate of interest. It's a nominal rate of interest, and it's compounded monthly. So every month it gets compounded. So which means that, remember the compound interest we talked about, it just year compound interest, but in this case we talked about the monthly compound interest. So which means that K will be substituting with monthly. So this is 12. K takes a value of 12. So P, initial capital, the number of years is 5, nominal interest rate is 12%, convert that into decimals, 12 by 100 is 0.12 per year, and K equal to 12 because compounded monthly per year. Okay, so APY equals to 1 plus the rate APR, which is the I, nominal rate of interest, divided by 12, the whole power 12. So Y 12 is the K, value of K, and then minus 1. This is something like 0.126825. So APY is the effective rate. You can take I star, or some books they will give I star, because to some book they call, they put I and above a line, overline they call. So that's up to you, but I prefer to keep the name itself APY. So in this case is I star rather than I, or in this case you can even take that to be the compound interest formula is future value is equal to present value multiplied by 1 plus I the whole power n. So in this case, instead of I equals to 12%, we'll substitute 12.68%, which is nothing but 0.126825 and power 5, which is the n. N is equals to 5, and you'll get something called 18,167. So which means that after 5 years, my account will have 8,167 rupees extra. So I just rounded off this to near decimals. So this is how it happens if you calculate the effective rate of interest. But if you talk about instead of that 12.6825, if you substitute only the 12, then you get the lesser money. So that will not be actually your money that will be there in a bank after. I mean, effective rate will not be there. So there'll be a nominal rate only, but effective rate won't be there. So this is kind of a pretty important thing when which we look into the compounded monthly. But the same problem, we just take using our regular example. So which means that I've got something called the principal, which is the capital, and number of years is equal to 5, and rate of interest is 12%, K is equal to 12, compounded monthly per year. So N is equal, convert everything in terms of months. So because we will be taking that in terms of monthly, then N is equal to 5 years, so 5 into 12 is 60 months. Then I is equal to 0.12 per year. So which means that 0.12 divided by 12, because year to month is divided by 12, is equal to 0.01 decimal in terms of per month. Then it is actually 1% per month, so it's 0.01 per month. And now you substitute directly instead of the value of I equals to 12, instead of that you take this I, so this will be 0.01, and instead of everything in terms of months, so this is a principal, 1 plus 0.01 whole power 60. It's not 5, it is 60. And that also yields the same result. So this is kind of a little confusing. So it'll be better if you take this formula and you can substitute it. You can find the effective rate of interest, something like that. This is pretty straightforward as well. So convert only I value, then substitute that APY here, then you'll get the formula. But here, if you have to convert everything in terms of a month, then that's kind of, it's monthly is fine, but there are some cases you'll be doing it quarterly, weekly, semi-annually, then this might cause some lot of trouble. So I recommend you to stick with the same example. This is example number 2, And in this case, we have taken this compounded quarterly. Quarterly is every 3 months. So which means that 4 threes are 12. So 4 quarters in a month. So for first, what we do is like we take the principal year of final year, which we look into, then rate of interest and k is equal to 4. Why k is equal to 4 is it is quarterly. So quarterly has k value to be 4. And we'll be substituting the value of k here. And which is nothing but 4 and 4, and we'll get something called effective rate, and that you substitute here in the formula, you'll get something called 18,061, and excess money will be 8,062, so something like quarterly. So if you talk about monthly, the rate of the final amount is 167, whereas 103 rupees is lesser when you compare to quarterly. And this is how you look into the different sectors. Same way you can do it for a regular basis, like you have to convert all that into a quarters. And 5 years is 5 into 4, 4 is per year. Per year you have 4 quarters, and 5 years is 5, 4, so 20 quarters. And per year we have this percentage of interest, and we wanted to convert in terms of quarters, it's 0.03, which is 3% interest per quarter. And that substitute the value there, and you'll get something like 18,062, something like that. Okay. So I'll just round up this, so you can probably take a look at this. Then probably the task for today, or probably you can do it after CAT 1 as well. So do it for annually, semi-annually. Annually is 1 year per year, semi-annually is 6 months, and bi-monthly is just 2 months. Once in 2 months, something like we have got 6 months, which is pretty much similar to a semi-annually. Semi-annually is 2, because 2 6 months. This is number of 2 months, which is 6 2 months. And fortnightly is 15 days, and weekly and daily. The value of K differs, and you can take down from this table. That's pretty much, you can do this problem. I have uploaded this stuff in MS Teams, so kindly take a look at it. And the minimum attractive rate of return is very important. Just kindly, take a look at it. MIR is a minimum interest rate that is acceptable by an individual or an institution or organization. So that is why it has got no guidelines. It depends on the organization to accept or reject the proposal. To accept the financial burden of building a project or buying a specific product or equipment. So which means that if you talk about MRR to be 10%, and your investment yields you 12%, 10 is less than 12%, then it's not a profit. So you'll be incurring huge loss. But your MRR, minimum attractive rate of return, is 12%. Your investment only costs you 10%, then you can accept that. That's kind of a profitable. So only these terminologies are important, but it is up to you to accept or reject. Sometimes they'll say MRR equals to investment. That's ideal case. So if you expect what the bank gives, then that's magic. So, but even then it's not profitable, because you don't need any extra benefit out of this. So if you have some 12% over 10%, then you have some 2% extra that might fetch you a good thing for you. Or a profit is really important, rather than 10% equals to 10%, something like that. So that also can be considered neither profitable nor not profitable. It's just like the cat on the wall. It's up to you to accept. Sometimes your business is running very last, then if ARR equals to your investment, then you can go ahead, and because you can survive at that point of time rather than looking into the profit at that point of time. And this is a uniform payment series. We'll come back to this when we do a module number 4, which we'll be looking at the cost, different types of cost associated, and that cost can be extrapolated to something called competition or a market demand and so on. So we talk about that a little later, this particular series. This probably we have dealt in our detail in factors of production. And the last class, we talked about the Cobb-Douglas production function, and we talked about this, and we talked about one simple case of where the transformer, the output of the transformer, and I mean, it's a production function. I hope you would have done this a task, this is what we have done, asked you to do. Instead of 1200, substitute 1300, and the value of 38 to be 40, and just you can check that, something like that. You can take this 0.880, the other side, the power of 1 by something, then you'll get this. All the scientific calculators nowadays give this value, but if you wanted to find out, you can even find out this using logarithm. Log h 0.800 sum equals to this logarithm of that, then the logarithm value will get, then h is equal to anti-log of that, that will give us the value. So that is also a procedure you can find out. Now we'll go to very, very important thing. It's called the types of production function. This is a very, very interesting thing, and you should know because this is a core part of module number 3. How do you define a production function? There are 3 or 4 types or natures of production function. We'll be discussing about the these two things at this class. Probably when we come back to the next class, we'll talk about the other types of production function. And finally, we'll have got other factors as well to discuss tomorrow. But as of now, understand the types of production function. It is based on the length of the period, like how long is your period of decision making. Either it is a short period decision making, or for the short term decision making, or a long term decision, just like your continuous assessment test and final assessment test. So continuous assessment test will have a small portions, whereas final assessment test you have got the almost the entire portion, and all those things are called the short run on a long run. So short run, the plant capacity and technologies seem to be constant, and all other remaining factors are considered to be variable. In a long run, all the factors are considered to be variable. So there's no fixed factors. But if you make any factors fixed in a long run, that can converge to a short run decision making. The number of inputs and outputs, and 2 inputs and 1 output model, is called isoquants or isoproduct curve. We talk about that a little later. As understand this is something an important terminology, or 2 variable inputs, 1 variable inputs, and many variable inputs is what we call a many variable inputs is almost a longer run, whereas the smaller variable inputs and single variable inputs can be converted to a short run. So that is what it is, both the things are interrelated. And we'll have something called nature of returns, something model giving you increasing returns, and some model giving you constant returns, and some model giving you decreasing returns. Returns in the sense extra money or a profit or something like that. If a model gives you a constant return, then that is what we call economics of scale. And we'll talk about that a little later when we talk about the economics of scale, and economics and diseconomics of scale, and types of economics of scale, and so on. And the increasing rate of return is something that just you incorporate 1% and you will get 5% as a return. You increase the input by 5%, it yield 10%, something like double, triple, or more than a unity. If it is the same, then it's called constant return. But sometimes a model might give a decreasing return as well. But it's a short-term decision, because if some model is giving a decreasing return for over a period of time, it's better to shut down the particular business. So as simple as that. Then we talked about the elasticity of substitution and constant elasticity of substitution and variable elasticity of substitution. It just like talks about the one factor, how do we incorporate or change in the one factor influence the other factors, and we'll talk about that. This is kind of mathematical model associated with that, and we'll take a much detailed look into that a little later. Maybe after a CAT one exam. And short run versus long run. As I told you, in a short run, we'll have one factor to be fixed, one or more factors to be fixed, and that cannot be changed. It's called fixed factors. The factor that doesn't vary are called fixed factors or fixed input. Whereas a long run, it's just like all the factors are variable. And it's actually all productions can be changed. It's not cannot, it's can be changed. So as simple as that for long run. And when you talk about period of short run and long run, it is nothing like a small period, long period, 6 months, 3 months. There is no definite time period associated with the short run. A short run period can be 6 months, can even be a 6 years as well. Because when you talk about 60 years of a business, 6 years is something called a short run. So there's no time specific time period, but it should be decided based on the case by case basis by the experienced personnel and the company's head or something like administrators. And fixed inputs in short run represents the outcome of the previous, something like we consider fixed inputs, you know. So that can be from a longer run decision. So the short run, for example, if you run a business for 10 years, you know what is the factor that you should not change or vary. So that will be an influencing or a fixed factor if you consider a short run duration or a shorter interim decision making as well. So that's what it means by that might the fixed inputs may be from a longer decision, long run decision as well. And this is what we have done for the production function for a transformer thing. EE Numbers has developed this formula. And this is a long run and short run production function. This is an imaginary or hypothetical production function. It has two variables, L and K. At this point, you should be knowing what is L and K. L is the labor and K is the capital. Okay, capital in rupees and labor in numbers. And something for a construction, they say they have a production function like this. And this is a long run production function. Has got all the factors or not variables. But if you happen to know one factor, like for example, if L is equal to 55, either L or K, you can convert this into a short-term decision making or short-term production function. And this is the one. When L is equal to 55, substitute in equation 17, this entire thing gets converged into 2501.25 plus 36.2K minus 0.60K square. So this will, if you know L, you can make up the entire equation in terms of K. So this will become a short-term decision making, and whereas one fixed, another variable, whereas in this case long-term decision making, all the factors are variable. So in this case, simply I've given only two variables. You can have n number of variables as well. So but the more the number of variables, it'll be very difficult to converge into a production function. Say for example, you have 15 variables, then it will be very, very difficult to formulate an equation based on that, because each factor behaves differently and it's be very difficult to converge them into a equation. And if you know K equal to 80, just a random value of given 80, then you can convert this in terms of a production function. I mean this particular production function. Okay, so that has given us an foundation for one of our very, very interesting production function. It's called one variable input production function. So before we get into that one variable production function, let's take a look at the average and the marginal product. So the average product of an input is the ratio of total output divided by the total input. So this is just like an efficiency or an average. You take the calculation of X divided by the total number of inputs, something like that. In this case, AP, average product is output by inputs, is equal to Q by IP. This is very, very, very important. It's called marginal product. So marginal product is extra input you get, or extra output you get by adding one additional unit to that input, while other inputs are held constant, is called the marginal product. It's just something like there are some people who really take their time in even submitting the ungraded assignment. So if I start giving them the grades, extra grades, their efficiency gets increased. Not only their efficiency gets increased, their interest gets increased, but also the people who have not a habit of submitting the ungraded assignments also will get it, because the grades are marks are motivation. So that's as simple as that. If you could able to produce good materials, or if you could able to have a good machining process or even infrastructure developed, so that a small quantum you invest, if it results in a huge benefit, then that's what we call a marginal product or the excess product or something like that. So this is very important. The change in output divided by the change in input. This is the what you call the relative terminology. So which means that average product is nothing but Q by the input, and this is the difference in the output divided by the difference in the input. So that's what we call a marginal product. If the marginal product is negative, then it's not profitable. If it is positive, it's always profitable. If it is equals to the average product, then it's neither profitable nor loss, because it's the same as average of product. Then there's no point in adding extra things, because you're not, say for example, if you run a business and the business yields 5,000 rupees, but if you provide an additional capital, say for example, initially the capital is 1 lakh rupees, you'll get 5,000 as a profit every month. In the other case, it is like 1,20,000. I've invested 20,000. If it yields 10,000 or 7,000, then that's profitable. A little bit extra you'll get out of the norm. But if you invest despite 1,20,000, and if it yields the same, the amount just equivalent to a 5,000, then that's not profitable. But if it is less than 5,000 despite the money invested, then that's a huge disadvantage. So as simple as that. So all these things are decided based on the marginal product. Let's take a look at this small example. This is a production function or production equation or production table or column with one variable inputs, labor. So the quantity of labor I've just listed down. So zero is nothing, like it has at no output. If you have one labor, the total output is 10, and the average product is nothing but Q by L, which is 10 by 1 is 10. Then marginal is change in the the product divided by the change in the output divided by the change in the labor. So 10 minus 0 is 10 divided by 1 minus 0 is 1. So 10 by 1 is 10. Let's take a look at this quantity 5. So you have total output is 89 divided by 5 is 17.8, and this marginal product is calculated based on the previous thing, and this is the 89 minus 6 is 20, and minus divided by 5 minus 4 is 1, so this will be 20. So this is the marginal product, something like that. Since for this small example I've given without much variation in terms of quantity, but sometimes 1, 4, 16, and so on, like the total output varies. And in that case, marginal product is not always the denominator to be 1. It could be different as well. Okay. But in a tabular column, you may not get much inference. So we visually look into that in form of a graph. So this is a graph. This is a total production function, output divided by the amount of labor. And we have got this beautiful curve, so which means that a curve increases at some point and decreases after that. So which means that when the amount of labor increases, the production output also gets increased, but at a certain point of time, it decreases. And this is a very interesting curve, which means that this is the marginal product. So marginal product increases and decreases at one point, and the average product increases and decreases at one point. So there's a rule that after the point of the decrease of the marginal input, the average also gets decreases. And if the marginal product is above the average, says the, if the marginal product is greater than the average product is increasing. If the marginal product is less than the average, then the average product is decreasing. So this is kind of a patterns the economist generally looks into. This is just one factor, one variable inputs, and we could able to correlate the total production function. But when you talk about this curve and this curve, say the curve is something like 4, this point of time 4. At this 4, it started to, at this point of time, it's almost straight. And at this after 4, it gets wobulating. Then at this point, say for example, 5.5, and the 5.5, it started decreasing and so on. So this, you can correlate both the curves as well. Okay, so this is an interesting curve that you should look into. But this is the factor. When the marginal product is greater than the average product is increasing. If marginal product is less than the average product, then the average product is decreasing. So which means that average product is the average, it's just like an average percentage or a whenever papers are checked, people generally ask what is the class average. Why? I mean, they have to look into their status. If they are higher than the class average, then they'll be happy. If they are lower than the class average, they should take some precaution, or next time they should really do better, or they have to find out a way that have to improve in their grading, or not grading, academics, and so on. So that is pretty much an important thing when you compare an average product. So same way here, marginal product is an extra product that is get out of your extra input. So if that extra input is less than average product, it's just kind of not going to be acceptable. So despite multiple training, the person could not able to achieve the average result, then it's very difficult for the person to cope up with the actual nature. And this has probably taken us to a new dimension called law of diminishing marginal return. So this is pretty much a very, very, very important concept. So just understand this, as a user of a variable input or something like this is pretty much important. At one point, the marginal productivity will decrease despite the increase in the the input. So which means that the use of a variable input increases in equal increment. So in the previous example, I can show it increases with the additional increment. Or you see the quantum labor incorporated, it gets increased, and the output of the that thing also get increased. But at one point it started declining. At one point it started declining, and it can go. It has gone beyond the positive value. It has gone negative values. You can see here, it went zero, and it went -10 and -5 as well. So that is what we call a law of diminishing marginal return. It means that you should understand this point. The point at which the marginal return decreases is what we call diminishing return. So there's no point in keep on adding till if you still add, it go negative and beyond certain limit, negative of certain limit. So it's better to stop at this point of time. So which means that the optimum labor they can go with this is 4. If they could able to go 4, their productivity will be something around 27 or something. Something like 20, something like that. So that is what basically 24 or something. That is what basically the law of diminishing return states. At one point, it eventually rise, and a point will eventually be reached at which the marginal product of a variable input declines. So that is what we call a law of diminishing marginal return. It's also known as law of diminishing marginal productivity, because if we talk about labor, it is a productivity, so it gets decreased. But basically, law of diminishing marginal returns are applied to short run, whereas one factor is fixed, other factors are variable. But it can even use for long run, provided one or more inputs among the variable inputs or total variable inputs are retained unchanged. So in that case, long run can be converge into a short run, or something like law of diminishing marginal return. Okay.